cold start. Pump up the bulb. Start.
It's 17, 18 miles an hour. That's actually 19. Very easy going. Settles back down to a real nice idle. This acceleration in top end. I want to show how stable this boat is. If you've never been in a canoe before, they are incredibly stable for their size. Now I weigh 240 pounds and there's nothing in here to hold me out, and I am standing all the way up against the edge of the boat and no troubles. That's me doing all I can do, and I'm a big fella. So I'll show the trolling motor. I have an extending handle and rack it up front allows you to just drop it in. Actually, when I'm just sitting here, I like to have that handle up just a little bit. Brand new battery. I have a flat floor up in the front because it's where I stand when I fish. And this thing actually moves right along with just the trolling motor. I'll put it on 5 there. You can see the thing moves right along even with just the trolling motor. Stand up here to fish. It's a very stable platform. Again, I can't even hardly move the thing around, which, given how light the boat is pretty amazing. So, I want to pull the trolling motor back up and show you how easy it goes on the trailer. Okay, this trailer does not have side guides, but you really don't need them because all you have to do to drive it on, and apparently over one of my dogs, is to get the bow of the boat in between the two bunks and it'll just scoot right up there. Got a little bit of current in the river right this minute. I like to compensate for it just a little bit. Alright, had to go in at an angle because of the current, but once you get it up there in between those bunks, all you gotta do is just aim it. Give it a little gas. And you're on. Alright, I'm back at the shop now and I'm going to do gear case leak down and I'll do a compression test so that you can see that. Now this was my motor, so I know everything's good, but it's one thing to say it's good, and it's another thing to show that it's good. So I will open up the shop and get out the tools and get it done. Alright, I want to go ahead and drain the fluid and change the fluid while I'm shooting this video. Because really and truly, you can argue about it, but really you should drain the gear case in order to do an effective pressure test. So we're going to go ahead and pull the plugs, and that way you'll know when you get it that it's got fresh fluid in it also. And get that to back out. There we go. And something I want to point out here, it wasn't causing a problem, but I just didn't like it, so I fixed it. This bearing carrier right here, the old one that was in here, had a little crack that was starting to work its way back up in here, and I didn't like that, so I bought a new bearing carrier and stuck that in the lower unit. So you'll know that you've got a fresh bearing carrier, and we're going to show that the seals are good in just a minute with that pressure test. That oil probably has 10 or 15 hours on it, and as you can see, you've got no water in it whatsoever. Plus, with a new bearing carrier, you also get new front side seals. So the only seal that's old in the thing, which is not really old, but that's going to be the drive shaft seal and the shift shaft seal. But we're going to prove that those are perfectly fine. While the lower unit's finishing up draining, I want to mention the things that are new on this unit. One of them is we've got a new alcohol resistant fuel line, have a new power pack. When I replaced the power pack, I went ahead and ordered brand new CDI coils, so these coils are brand new. Everything's wired in. Of course, you saw that it runs great. We even have new spark plugs in there, so you won't have to do anything to this motor for a long time. Okay, I've got the pressure gauge installed in the upper plug hole. Bottom screw is in with the old seal, and I will replace the seals when I put it back up. I'll show that in a minute. Oh, there it is. That's the bag of OMC seals that I have. So it'll have new seals, but I want to pressure test it with the old seals. I know there was nothing wrong with them, so let me grab the pump. Okay, I've got it at 14 PSI. Let me grab my phone so we can check the time. I'll run it for at least 15 or 20 minutes. I didn't even need to do that, did I? Okay, the time is 5:40. Now I'm going to take the plugs out and do a compression test while that's taking place. A moment ago I forgot to mention that with new coils come the new spark plug wires. So we got brand new spark plug wires. And let's see, the number one cylinder, which I have prepared for the compression test, you can tell by looking at it, it's absolutely perfect. So, alright, I have the number one cylinder grounded out, the ignition, so it won't hurt it. And I have the compression tester in cylinder number one. You can see I'm at zero now, so let's give it about three pulls. Got the throttle turned all the way off because we wouldn't want it to try to fire. I forgot to run the fuel out of it a moment ago, so. Okay, we're right at 90 pounds. Back this out. Get that plug back in that cylinder. I don't have to get it all the way in because I'm not running it. I just want to make sure that the ignition is grounded out. You don't want to hurt your ignition by not having it grounded when you do a compression test. Now, I'd already loosened this bottom spark plug, so we'll pull out the number two plug and take a look at it, then ground that spark plug wire. You can see it's perfect also. Put it down right there. Ground out that spark plug wire. Get our compression tester in that cylinder. And again, I release the pressure so it's at zero. Saw this spark came off, but it was sparking, so no damage. And you can see that one is right at 90 pounds also. So cylinders are perfectly even. I will back this out, put the top end back together, and then we'll check that lower unit pressure in the time. I should have said a moment ago, as I put these plugs back in, what really matters when you're running a compression test is not the static number. And the reason why is because compression gauges vary. The thing that matters is, are they even between the cylinders on the same gauge? And rule of thumb is, you don't want to see more than a 5% variance between cylinders. Of course, with a two cylinder, that's pretty easy to see. But in any case, this one is perfectly even, so we know that there's no unusual wear in either cylinder. I'm going to give it a few more minutes on the gauge, which hasn't moved not even a bit. Explain the crazy colors of this thing. This actually is a 1978 Johnson 15. that I got from a friend who owns a pawn shop, I want to say 3 years ago, and it was in terrible cosmetic condition, and the propeller was beat up and it needed a little bit of help. So anyway, 1975, for whatever reason, is one of my favorite colored Johnson decal sets. And two, a lot of people like to fish on restricted lakes like High Falls that have 9.9 horsepower restriction. And really and truly, in 1978, in 77, and in 76, the only difference between a 9.9 and a 15 was the carburetor. That started to change in 1978 because they added a reed stop that the 9.9 did not have in the 15 horsepower units. And then later on, they started messing around with the exhaust tuners. But as far as this year goes, the true year of the motor, which is 78, the only difference between the 9.9 and the 15 was a carburetor. But with the 9.9 stickers, you wouldn't have a hard time if you're fishing on a restricted lake. And so that's why I went with 9.9. And I just think the 1975 decals look really, really cool. The strange colored lower half, I actually sort of wanted to look like the 1975 also, but couldn't find the right paint. Thought I found some tractor paint that might be close, and when I shot it, I was bad wrong. But it doesn't look bad at all with the boat, because the boat itself is green, and so it really looks kind of neat. Let me show some things about the trailer here. We have a almost brand new jack stand. It does swing away. Wheels in perfect shape. I just rewired this trailer today, so all of the wiring in the trailer is brand new. Also put on new bunk carpet, so the trailer's in very good shape. You'll see it's got bearing buddies, and the tires are in very good shape. And so everything about the trailer is good. This whole package is so light you could probably pull it with a bicycle. And I'll take this off and show you how light it actually is as you roll it around. I'm gonna pull it up off of here. First of all, tongue weight, two fingers. Not very much tongue weight. Very, very easy to push around. This boat weighs 165 pounds. The trailer doesn't weigh very much. There's not a car out there you could put a trailer hitch on that wouldn't pull this just fine. Another nice thing about it is pulling it with this old ragged minivan. I still get 24, 25 miles a gallon, so you can get really good gas mileage with your tow vehicle with this unit too. It is a great river boat. It draws very little water. It'd be a good flats boat, again, because it draws very little water. Brand new trolling motor battery. The Minn Kota has very little time on it. I actually run it like this. If you wanted to, you could run it in the down position. I just don't like to mess with all that. I like to have it up, have the collar tight, and when you get to where you are, you can just reach around and release that, and boom, you're fishing. So trolling motor is great. Navigation lights, socket back here, socket in the front. All you do is just plug it in. It's all wired into the battery. The lights work. Got a great set of rod holders here. When I'm fishing in the front, I like to put the butts of the rods right here on the seat and then run them up through there. And if you're fishing with two people, the person in the back can run the butts of their rods back on that bench seat up forward, and then the person in the front can run theirs in the back. So it's great about keeping the rods out of your way. There is storage in the center seat. Right now I've got a spare prop in there, which of course go with the boat. You can put life preservers in there, tackle or whatever. You don't need this, but there is a bungee strap to hold that down. It won't come up though. Brand new gas tank, brand new fuel lines, brand new filter on the fuel line. Everything is in very good shape, ready to go. All Alright, I've muddled around long enough to where I can show the leak down results. It is 6 o'clock right now, as you can see by my same phone. Oh, you know what? I'm going to use the flashlight to make sure that we can see the gauge. Alright, as you can see, we're still exactly in the same place, so there's no pressure leak whatsoever. Seals are perfect. If you've never performed this operation, the key, and it's much better to use a pump, is to get it in the bottom until it comes out the top, like so. Once it's coming out from the top, you go ahead and put in your top seal first. There we go, got that started. Now get it cranked down with a new seal. There we go. Then you pull out the bottom, and you need to have that ready. But because a vacuum is formed in the lower unit, it's not like it just comes flying out. So I've got a little pressure on there, and now I want to pull it out and stick in the plug, like so. And you'll see it didn't just come rushing out of there. It can't, because when you put in the top plug, it creates a vacuum. And that is the only way to get a full lower unit of oil. Compress those new seals, and we'll wipe it down, and you are now ready to go.